Good afternoon. At the outset, I would like to thank AIOS for giving me this opportunity for presentation. So I'll be speaking about the first and foremost topic, that is the evaluation of ptosis. As we all know, ptosis of the upper eyelid is drooping of the upper eyelid margin to a position lower than normal, which is 1.5 to 2 millimeter. As you can see in this photo, left eye ptosis is there. Ptosis can be divided into congenital or acquired, and the congenital variant can be further classified into either a simple ptosis or a complicated if there is association with blepharophimosis, double elevator palsy, superior rectus weakness, or a synkinetic ptosis. Now, these are few of the famous personality who do have some kind of a lid disorder. As you can notice, Ranveer has a left eye mild ptosis. John has this right eye inverse ptosis. And Lalita Pawar, who during a shoot got slapped and developed a left eye traumatic ptosis. So why we need to evaluate? So as to avoid this complication like undercorrection, overcorrection, temporal flare, or suture granuloma. And a proper evaluation at the end, we should have answers to these questions. What is the type of ptosis, whether it's unilateral or bilateral? We should make a surgical decision what we are going to do in that patient and rule out any contraindication for surgery and identify any factor which necessitates change in the surgery. So a complete evaluation will include history, examination, investigation, and at the end, we should have a choice of surgery. In history, age of onset, progression, diurnal variation, change with jaw movements, and history of previous ocular surgery, along with that, any history about family history, like in cases of BPES or myotonic dystrophy, history of bleeding tendencies has to be ruled out. Now, coming on to examination, first and foremost, rule out pseudoptosis. Like in this patient, there is a left eye ptosis on appearance. When we ask the patient to fix it with the left eye, you can see the ptosis has disappeared. A complete ptosis workup is done in under these following 15 headings. I'll go one by one, very, just touching on to the important points. First and foremost, why vision is important? Because most of these patients have anisometropic amblyopia. Stimulus deprivation is seen in cases with a severe unilateral ptosis only. And it's rare in bilateral cases because they develop an essential chin up position in cases with a bilateral ptosis. Pupil is important to rule out Horner syndrome and third nerve palsy. Second is head posture. As I already mentioned, bilateral ptosis, you develop this chin up position. Frontalis overaction has to be carefully looked on, like in this patient with a left eye severe ptosis. Lid fold is important. We want a dynamic lid crease at the end of surgery in a post-op patient. That's the reason we take a LPS stump while doing a LPS resection. Otherwise, lid won't be dynamic. So lid fold evaluation is always essential. Lid crease is again important so as to plan the surgical incision site. If multiple, then the most prominent one should be considered. Generally in women, we consider it to be around 8 to 10 millimeter and men around 5 to 7 millimeter. The amount of ptosis, as we all know, whether it's mild, moderate or severe ptosis, depending upon the MRD, the margin reflex distance. The palpebral pressure, height and width is also important. Levator function grading is the most important factor in the correct choice of surgical procedure. In children, what we do is an eyelift test, and the levator function we test by measuring the distance that the eyelid moves in millimeter from a maximum down gaze to maximum up gaze without elevating the eyebrow. So this is the correct way of doing maximum down gaze to maximum up gaze, and that is what the levator grading is. Eyelift test is specially for children. If the levator action is good, lid revert on its own when we ask the patient to look up. Vertical tarsal height is another important factor for patients where we want to do fascinalis servet. The vertical tarsal height should be more than 8 millimeter if you want to do fascinalis servet for mild ptosis patients. Again, lid lag to differentiate congenital and acquired. Bell's phenomenon is another important thing. If it is reverse Bell's, which is an upward and inward movement, or an inverse like downward and inward, that is not a contraindication for surgery because here the exposure of the cornea is not that much. So if the Bell's is poor, where more than half of the cornea is visible, that is the only kind of contraindication for doing a ptosis surgery. This is how we test the Bell's. Now coming on to the Marcus gun, my second talk is on Marcus gun. You can see Marcus gun can be of various type. This is a mild Marcus gun where you can see on opening the jaw there is a mild Marcus gun. This is the patient with a moderate Marcus gun where you can see the 2 to 5 millimeter excursion is there. This is very severe Marcus gun where more than 5 millimeter excursion of the lid is there on protrusion of the jaw. This is a patient with a bilateral Marcus gun. This is the patient with bilateral Marcus gun. You can see in the right eye, also see the movement in the left eye. And this is the patient, interesting patient with an inverse Marcus gun, where on opening the jaw, there is droop in the lid. It's not winking, it is drooping actually. So this is an inverse Marcus gun kind of a thing. Another important thing is extraocular movement to rule out superior rectus under action. Corneal sensation has to be tested, TFM evaluation with a Schirmer's test. And most and important, finally, you have to look for the old photographs if you are suspecting an acquired ptosis. Like this patient, there was no ptosis. Gradually, there was ptosis and it increased to this level. This was one of the acquired cases. Now, to just briefly touch upon the special forms, I'll just mention the important points. Congenital ptosis, you want to see lid lag on down gaze. In superior rectus, weakness, as we already seen, because superior rectus and LPS has the same mesodermal origin, so most of the patient you need to rule out superior rectus. Blepharophimosis syndrome, where you see family of patients. Marcus gun phenomenon, which is seen in bilateral in 4% cases, has to be ruled out. Secondary aponeurotic ptosis like involutional dehiscence or disincision will be there, like senile ptosis where you have a high lid crease. Aponeurotic ptosis where you can see in patients like blepharocolesis, post-traumatic ptosis, mechanical ptosis, few of the myogenic ptosis like chronic progressive external ophthalmologia, which are the contraindication for surgery. What we can give is crutch glasses in these patients and few of the pseudoptosis. So that is what a complete evaluation of ptosis should need, and at the end of ptosis evaluation we will come to a conclusion that we have to proceed with what kind of a surgery. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.